All right, I hope you guys have a little bit of time here because we've never done a U2 biography, and boy, this was a daunting task, both as a biography and heading into this album. But
Did you
before
fly to
that,
Ireland to do
yes, yeah, I,
research?
for recon, yeah, just this week, just overnighted it. But I don't know in what order you put them, Josh. I did recommend With or Without You and Where the Streets Have No Name. Which did you put where?
I did not make the montage yet, so you can
All right, so
choose
let's
whatever you
have
want.
Where the Streets Have No Name will be in the montage, and now you'll hear a little bit of With or Without You. Okay, so two of the three massive singles on this. There is another fourth single, In God's Country, that also was a pretty big hit, but maybe not at that same level. But before I get into all that, Matt, run the numbers for us.
There you go, John. Okay, so U2's The Joshua Tree comes in at number six in the 1980s on Best Ever Albums, number one in 1987, number 51 of all time. It is U2's highest rated album on Best Ever Albums, and this is the only album that we're covering tonight that made Rolling Stone's list, coming in at number 135. And U2 ranks number 25 of overall artist rankings on Best Ever Albums.
Okay, so the story of U2 begins in 1970s. That was my attempt at being Irish storyteller at that.
Wow.
So anyway, yeah, sorry, that wasn't very good, but you try things and sometimes they hit. I did laugh that Josh gives us names each week, and he named himself the drummer from U2, which is sad because Larry Mullen Jr. deserves more than that. I don't know how to feel about me being called Bono, by the way, as well. So I can't see if Matt's the Edge
He
or
is.
okay,
I'm
or
the edge.
yeah. Yeah,
No, no love for Adam
or
Clayton
no, Adam
tonight.
Clayton, yeah, and Josh was sort of like, I don't know who the other guys are, but I know Matt knows who the other guys are, so we'll do that. So, but
Pavarotti,
anyway,
Domingo, and the other guy.
yeah, well, Larry Mullen Jr., who was 14 years old and a student at Mount Temple Comprehensive School in good old Dublin, Ireland, decided that he was going to start a band, and he placed a note on the school's notice board, which I guess is the equivalent of putting in that thing in Melody
Magazine,
Maker, but when
yeah,
you're
that's the
14,
Irish
but
version of Melody
yes,
taken out an ad.
when you're
Yeah,
14. And so
yeah.
he asked for musicians for a new band. And in one of these things that is always amazing to me, right? It's like you do that random thing, and then at the cavil call, five people show up, and Mullen is on drums, and the five people that showed up just happened to be Paul Hewson, who you may know better as Bono, David Evans, who you may know better as The Edge, Adam Clayton, who Josh doesn't know, but Matt and I know better as U2's bassist, a gentleman named Ivan McCormick, and then David Evans, i.e. The Edge's older brother, Dick Evans. And you just don't see a lot of Dicks anymore. But this is D-I-K, Dick Evans on guitar. So that is the original one. Initially, the band was called the Larry Mullen Band, but that didn't stick. And even Larry Mullen himself says it was the Larry Mullen Band. And then Bono walks in, and any chance I had of being in charge was blown, which I thought was pretty funny. Yep. And a friend of theirs loans the guitar and amplifier for them, and they practice. And they found out that pretty much none of them could play. But this was the era, right, of punk music, and they were influenced by, at this point in time, at least, by the Jam, the Clash, the Sex Pistols, the Buzzcocks, all the main ones. They decided that was no impediment to stopping a band, not being able. It's kind of like how we're amateur music podcasters, and it didn't stop us from starting a show. Maybe same idea right here. So, Mr. McCormick, Ivan McCormick, was not long for the band. He lasted a couple weeks before he was gone. So at this point, they are down to five pieces because Dick Evans is still there. They are rehearsing in their music teacher's classroom at school, which somehow is both hilarious and exactly what I would imagine U2's origin story would be. And they play their first gig for an audience in April 1977 at a local high school. They then decide to change their name to the hype, I should mention that their initial name was Feedback, and they picked that because it was a term they music term they knew. So
that true story. It could have been that or the notes.
They were really
I read that in multiple occasions. Music. So they the name of it took a while. So they went from Feedback to the hype, and then Dick Evans is older than the rest of the band. He's going to college, and he just sort of gets edged out a little bit because they decide they want to be a four-piece, and he, depending on what story you read, he's either amicably leaves or just kind of goes away. And they decide over time, they keep playing, and they decide over time in March 1978 to change their name to U2. They actually got they got a list of names from a gentleman named Steve Avril, who was in a band called The Radiators that we didn't cover, but has a somewhat well-known name in punk rock. And there were six potential names, and the band chose U2 from that list because they felt it was ambiguous and open-ended, which, once again, definitely tracks for U2.
Yeah.
And because it was the name on the list they dislike least. So there you go. Around the same time, they won a talent contest in the wonderfully named town of Limerick. That was sponsored, like, some of these things are hilariously Irish, like, that they were in Limerick and they won a talent contest sponsored by Harp Lager. And this one allows them to, and they're one of many bands, there are a couple other bands we talked about that had these opportunities too. I was trying to remember, so anyway, what I'm trying to get at is they won a monetary prize and a recording session for a demo for CBS Ireland. I remember another band we covered won that as well, and they were supposed to be produced by Nick Lowe, if I remember, but they didn't end up doing it, but I couldn't for the life of me remember what band that was, but similar story there. I'll have to, if you can remember, let us know.
Maybe
but,
like Orange Juice or something. I don't
remember. I don't know. I can't remember who it was. Somebody, yeah, like in that era. So anyway, they credit this win with being important because it verified that they were actually starting to get good at playing their instruments as opposed to their early days. They play a farewell show with Dick Evans around this time, which is also quintessentially U2 to have a farewell concert for a guy before they're even anybody, right? But once again, and
they're also inclusive, you know, U2.
And then Dick joins the Virgin Prunes, another band. So there you go. They record their first demo tape in April 1978. But they really don't know what they're doing, and it doesn't go very well. You'd think they'd give them a producer, but I guess not, just the studio time itself. So they start to get noticed, interestingly enough, in mid-1978 by an Irish magazine named Hot Press, who sort of starts to become, talk them up, I guess is the best way to do it. But more importantly, a journalist at the magazine introduces them to a gentleman named Paul McGinnis, who was able to kind of get them more properly recorded and bring a little bit more professionalism to their shows and their gigging and stuff like that. They end up recording demos in summer of 1979, and it ends up becoming an EP that's only released in Ireland called Three. And they print 1,000 copies of that, and they all sell out, and the band thinks they're on to something. And they're playing bigger and bigger shows in the Irish market, and they're getting a little bit of buzz there. And eventually, I'll kind of skip ahead a little bit. They eventually get with Steve Lillywhite, and who will once again come back later, but you know we've mentioned him many times on CTS. And they record their debut album, Boy. And that was released in October 1980 and was well-received by the rock press. And that theme, and U2 always has a theme in Bono in his albums, that one was about like boyhood, right? Childhood, boyhood, adolescence, stuff like that, coming of age. So, it actually gets as high as number 52 in the UK and number 63 in the United States. Do you guys know the big single off of Boy? It's a great song.
I Will Follow.
You got it. Yep. I Will Follow is the song that breaks them through. They then release in 1981 the album October, and there's a lot of stuff going on with that, including Bono losing the lyrics to the album at a performance in Portland, and kind of having to like sort of do them on the fly, like remember what's going on there. But that album has the song Fire as the lead single and also does relatively well. Lily White was the producer there as well. That album, October, was about spiritual themes. Shocking, Bono writing about spiritual themes. That I don't know if you read the lyrics on this one, Matt, but that's one of Bono's go-tos. Mm. It also had the single Gloria, which is probably better known as what, guys? Who had Gloria first?
Them.
Correct.
Yeah, Van Morrison. Yeah.
I was about to say Van Morrison. Yep, and Them, yeah. Exactly. So that one's in there. And then we fast forward ahead to 1982 and 83, actually January 83, where you get War, and that breaks them through in the UK for sure, and to some degree in the US, although some will say it isn't truly until this album, The Joshua Tree, where they totally break through in the US. But War is both critically well-received and breaks them. We get the Unforgettable Fire, which we also covered after this one. And then that leads us up to sort of the era leading up to The Joshua Tree. And it's important to know that The Unforgettable Fire was released in 1984, and this album was not released until March 9th, 1987. So in between that time, guys, a whole lot of stuff happened with U2, including them playing at Live Aid and sort of becoming one of the standouts of the entire show, right, in terms of their live performance. Very powerful. A lot of this time, though, the band is touring and traveling around, spending a lot of time in the United States, which becomes extremely important thematically for this album, because the theme of this album is sort of the contrast in Bono's mind of the band's love of America and the sort of the mythical America, right, with the real America that he sort of views in that, like, Reagan era, you know, inequality, poverty, cynicism,
disparity,
right, cynicism of the era, right, and different stuff like that. And how Bono got to that was he traveled extensively in both Central America and Africa during this time, especially to areas of high poverty, and thought it was really interesting to juxtapose sort of their Western outlook, but especially the American outlook, because they were doing a lot of touring in America, with Africa and Central America. Africa, where it becomes important, is it's like they saw a lot of poverty, but they said there was sort of a joy that they felt was kind of missing in Western societies in America, like an authentic joy, right? And in Central America, this was during, you know, Iran-Contra, you know, Nicaragua, you know, that's we're doing a lot in Central America, right, in the Reagan era to try to overthrow, you know, things like the Sandinistas and stuff like that. And not only just those, you know, left-leaning groups, but, you know, Haiti and stuff where we're sort of installing puppet dictators. And obviously we have our fraught relationship with Cuba and there's all kinds of stuff like that. So they were very much sympathetic to some of the folks who were pushing back against what they considered to be American imperialism. Bono also and the band participated in a lot of benefit concerts, most notably for Amnesty International. So this is the beginning of, like, Bono galaxy brain, right? I guess would be the best way to describe it. Like, and I don't say that lightly, right? Because he's very sincere. But this is where, like, U2, you know, starts to move into that era where they're singing about big themes and also their love of the United States. Because we'll talk about how the album title was picked, but it was inspired by the concept of the Joshua Tree, right? Which is something that I'll explain a little bit. But another thing that happened here was the band's roadie, Greg Carroll, who was 26 years old, and Bono's personal assistant, unfortunately died in a motorcycle accident in Dublin. The whole U2 group was really affected by that because he was well-liked. And actually, the band went back to New Zealand, where he was from, to attend his funeral, which was a Maori funeral, like one of the native groups of New Zealand, and to do that. So once again, a world look. So thematically, the Joshua Tree we talked about, Bono describes it as like his and the band's great romance with the United States, that even though they're Irish, they always considered part of their soul to overlap with the United States. And they always toured the country for at least 5 months per year throughout the 80s up to that point. And Bono had decided two things. Number one, he had sort of immersed himself in the writing of American writers like Flannery O'Connor and Norman Mailer and folks like that, so that he can kind of get a little bit more of a feel for parts of America he didn't understand as well. I don't know how familiar you guys are with either of those writers. I am quite a bit. I mean, they write sort of about sort of the open space areas of America, I think I would describe, like on the... Not like Kerouac on the road, but, you know, just sort of about those areas. They're sort of like a continuation of people like Sinclair Lewis and stuff like that, right? You know, writing about the America that's not the cities, right, or the glamorous parts. It's, yeah, like everyday America or and the West a lot as well. The other thing is that Bono and the band pretty much admitted that they'd always been influenced by punk and the early post-punk, and kind of Bono felt they didn't have their own musical roots. And I guess in he goes to New York in 1985 and he spends a lot of time with Keith Richards and Mick Jagger, which sounds like a funny story, but in this case is more about they kind of teach him about blues and country music because they were highly influenced themselves by American music. But that, and Bono and the rest of the band were not super familiar with any of that stuff. So the Edge was very hesitant at first to it. He liked sort of what he described as a more European sound, which I think is what they're describing as more synthetic, I think, along the way. And when you think of what was going on, right, in Europe and England and Germany and stuff, it was that. But I guess Bono gets taken by people like Howlin' Wolf and stuff like that and starts to become enmeshed in sort of Bono's vision. They just spend a lot of time immersed in the world of blues, R&B, and country music. And there are, if you listen to this album, there are elements of that quite a bit on this album. So the album itself, there's in the same amount more bio I go into, but let's get into the album itself because that's interesting as well. I should mention, by the way, that a lot of their introduction to like Howlin' Wolf and Robert Johnson and people like that was on American Public Radio, which I thought was very interesting. They credited basically Free American Public Radio while they were driving around America as being where they got those sounds, especially late at night and stuff like that. So this was a conscious decision to make an American sounding album without sort of new wave or synth type influences. So U2 decides in late 1986, in 86, that they're going to release an album in late 1986. Spoiler alert, they don't until March 1987. But they buy a house in Ireland in the foothills of the Wicklow Mountains. The Edge had purchased seen this house when he was house hunting and convinces the owner to rent it to the band, and they decide to record in there. So a great CTS tradition, right? People basically buying a space, right, to record for inspiration. They set up a makeshift control room with mixing consoles, tape machines, all that good stuff, and a drawing room for recording and performing. Up until this point, the band had kind of recorded in a room together, but now they recorded their parts individually and brought them into the studio. So that was a big difference in this one compared to other ones. The other thing that is probably important to bring about this is they brought in a gentleman by the name of Brian Eno to work with them on this album. Yeah, so the recording of this album was both sort of exhilarating but also complex. Eno and another producer Lenoy is the last name.
Daniel Lenoy.
You got it. Yep.
Peter Gabriel.
Yep, he did Peter Gabriel.
Which they also, similarly, they rented a house in the farm in the middle of nowhere, just built the studio in some sort of random room in the farmhouse.
It's a thing, right?
The folks thing, yeah.
I think it's Landois, John.
I think it's Landois.
That's what I thought. I apologize. I'm usually the person getting on you guys for not doing your homework right there, but this... I'll be honest, this was an overwhelming bio right there, and I kind of tapped out on that one because condensing it was something else. So along with the R&B references, they do mention quite a bit that The Edge, while keeping his trademark guitar sound, was influenced by The Smiths and My Bloody Valentine. Now, we've covered The Smiths plenty, so you got Johnny Marr's guitar work, and we haven't covered My Bloody Valentine yet, but... when we do, we can use that as a reference note to see if we agree that there is influence there.
2 weeks, it's coming up.
To show beyond sort of how the album sounds and the various recording tricks, which I won't get into, but there's things like Leno has them wear headphones. He didn't have them wear headphones, excuse me, and had them use monitor speakers to do their recording. There's a lot of very technical stuff of what they're doing with the use of tape machines. In terms of motivation, I'm sure there's some oblique strategies in there as well.
Oh, but, yeah.
You know, Eno always has like the sonic thing and gets in super early, the mad scientist part, but he also always has this weird like new age advisory feel, I feel like, on a like creative director feel on albums as well, and there's definitely that. But to show his value, at one point Bono goes to them in October of 86 that he wants this to be a double album. And The Edge expands. He goes, there would have been two records depending on which songs we decided to finish. There was one album that was going to be a blues album, and the other was going to be a European album, which was going to be my album. And Eno basically was like, yeah, I don't know about that.
Yeah. Thank you, Brian Eno.
And he told us, I know that any one of these new ideas is good enough to make a record, but we have to draw a line somewhere. I think it'll take a lot more time. We should probably just make a solo album. So once again, showing his utility in the room, Brian Eno keeping them away from that, what I don't think would have been a good decision right there. So they're trying to finish up this album at the end of 1986, and it just isn't going to happen. So in late December, they hired Steve Lillywhite again, who comes back in after doing their first three albums, to remix the singles and specifically, which I thought was interesting, make them more appealing to commercial radio. So U2 is one of the few bands that's very unabashed, right, about the fact that they want it to be gigantic and huge and were willing to eschew some of their coolness, right, for that.
Yeah.
So now let's talk about the cover. It was designed by Steve Averill, and it was supposed to evoke a feeling of America, especially the wide open spaces. So they were told about the Joshua Tree and Joshua trees in general in the deserts of the American Southwest, and they decided to use one on the sleeve. Bono loved the fact that it had religious significance, surprise, surprise, yeah. Including being tied to the Old Testament prophet Joshua. And the following day, Bono walks into the studio and declares that the album shall be titled The Joshua Tree, which was hilarious because, of course, Bono did that. And that morning, while driving on Route 190, they spotted a lone standing tree in the desert. Photographer... Anton Corbin, I believe is the pronunciation, though it's
the director.
Yes, I believe so. Yeah, he was a photographer for this. Yes. Oh, okay. Did I get it right? Anton.
Yeah.
I saw it pronounced that one. I did look up Anton Corbin, but you know, you never could tell with YouTube, right? If the people are saying it or they're just like us and clowns. Right. But Anton Corbin, finds a single tree and he took the photo of it. And so the Edge said it was a fairly spontaneous, photo. Anyway, as you might imagine, this one debuts at number one on the UK albums chart, making it the fastest selling album in UK history to that point. It received a platinum certification in the UK within 48 hours of being released, guys, which is insane.
As opposed to the 10 years it took Jane's Addiction to get nothing shocking.
48 hours. Yep.
Wow.
So, yeah. The album spent 2 weeks atop the UK albums chart and spent its first 28 weeks within the top 10. It charted in the UK for 201 weeks, ranking it amongst the top 10 longest charting albums in the nation's history to this day. US Billboard albums, the album debuted at number 7, the highest debut for one of their studio, the highest debut for any studio album in the U.S. in almost 7 years. So from 1980 to 1987, it was the highest debuting studio, highest debut for a studio album in the U.S. And 3 weeks later, it reached number one. I don't know if you know about the U.S. pop charts at that time, right? But it was specifically built around building you up to the number one. There was like a whole, like how they released albums, right? It was designed to not have you come in at number one. It was to build to singles so you don't burn out the album, right? That was the idea. So that's a little bit of why that was happening. So 3 weeks later, it reaches number one, which was considered to be a very quick rise to one on that chart. And it was the group's first album to top the charts in the U.S. It remained number one for 9 consecutive weeks and was the second longest reigning number one album in the U.S. that year. I did not look up what number one was, but I'm going to guess it was Bad by Michael Jackson would be my guess as to the only one that was there. The album spent a total of 120 weeks on the Billboard Top Pop Albums, 35 of them in the top 10, and it was certified as double platinum within 2 months.
Jeez.
So
this is a massive album.
And also, all of the group's previous albums re-entered the Billboard Top Pop Albums charts in 1987. The album won the Grammy Award for Album of the Year and Best Rock Performance, while also being nominated in all of the major Grammy categories. It didn't win all of them, but it was the first album in a long time to do all of those. And it led to a gigantic tour called the Joshua Tree Tour. That would go throughout the year 1987 and afterwards lead into what would become Octung Baby later, but also a concert album slash film, I guess would be the best way to describe it, would you say, Matt? What would you say?
That's a little bit
of everything.
It's hard
to describe. That's what I'm saying. It's hard to say what U2 went into. But anyway, a lot of what they moved into was based on stuff that was recorded on this Joshua Tree tour. I'm sure when I do Octung Baby in the 90s, which we absolutely will do in the 90s, I'll kind of get a little bit more into that era of U2. But I feel like I've done plenty of bio right there. I think it got kind of mixed up a little bit. I think it was supposed to be Josh on this one. So I'll let Josh do the lead on this one and then go into Matt. Thoughts, Josh?
Well, I definitely listened to this album at some point in my life, it's been a long time since I heard it. And it's also hard to kind of separate U2 from, everything that's come after and the Apple Music debacle or fiasco and the parody of him on South Park and
almost like... no band has been hurt more by sticking around than U2, have they? Yeah.
They've just become something other than what they were at this time period when this album was released and leading up to it, with the two albums that we have already discussed. And so I was trying to kind of listen to this album with unbiased, unvarnished glasses and trying to see what the magic was that caused this album to go double platinum in 2 months, and I didn't really get it at first. The first listen through, I was like, okay, the first 3 songs are obviously so recognizable, and I was like, okay, well, maybe it's just because they're like hit after hit. But then kind of as the album went on, I didn't really know the rest of the songs on the album or didn't remember them. And I was really into Bullet the Blue Sky, kind of like that sound. And I think ultimately it's just how this kind of captures what U2 would ultimately become in terms of their big sound with the Edge's guitar. And I definitely picked up more on the blues and country from the when you mentioned in the bio. I heard that more on here. I like how the songs are constructed on this, and something like With or Without You has kind of this slow build. They slowly add more and more elements. They add the guitar and then they add something else, and it kind of comes in. A lot of the songs come into these big like choruses and crescendos, I think there sonically there is like an appeal to this kind of big sound that kind of draws you in. As we said before, I think on War or Unforgettable Fire, like Bono's voice has this, he has this frontman quality that is, you know, kind of special and indefinable in some way. And it really works here. On subsequent listens, I definitely picked up more on like the spiritual and religious stuff kind of kept reoccurring, or I kept almost getting distracted by it in some ways. And I don't know what that was about, because I often don't notice it too much, but I think
Bono,
because it was,
loves to write about his parents and God.
Yeah, I think because it was so prominent and such like a strong through line throughout the album is what I picked up on. I really like it's a strong album throughout. I think there's not really any weak songs. I feel like the production is strong as well. Like, feel like Eno had a guiding hand in that in some ways. Like even at the end of Mothers of the Disappear, which is the last track, there's like a little electronic bit at the end that seems like something Eno would do. U2 is kind of has so much baggage with them that it's and it's interesting too from the bio how they didn't really have any like musical influences. They're kind of like created with the sole purpose of being famous, which is interesting.
Well, no, their musical influences were punk.
Okay.
They didn't have though the traditional British,
yeah,
you know, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, not like the Beatles or, you know, all these other bands that we've listened to. So yeah, it's sonically it sounds like, it's so like unfair, but it sounds like a U2 album. I don't know how to get into the qualities that sound appealing. I think I like War more. It was such a surprising kind of raw sound, more raw, I don't know, sound than this. It felt more refreshing than hearing this, maybe because this is such a prominent album with the singles, but I think War kind of had more like rock qualities to it, and maybe something with that Europeanness that they you know, that the Edge liked was brought to that, which made it more refreshing to me. But this is an enjoyable album. It didn't like kind of blow me away, or I didn't have any some sort of epiphany about U2 that I didn't know before. It is a solid album, but it's there's something about it that just kind of didn't hit home with me. I'm not like being harsh on it. It's just like, it's not, maybe it's like trying to build it up too much in your head or something, or the expectations of this album or having it are unfair. I enjoyed it, but it's not like the, you know, the be all end all for me, at least with U2 up to this point. So I don't know if I did a good job explaining myself this time.
Well, I would probably say this is the U2 album, right? Yeah. Like this, like,
oh,
the,
oh, for sure.
You know, I'd be yeah, like, it's, if you're a person that, I mean, there's definitely people out there that like the older, you know, it's the stuff that from War, right? That's, it's kind of got more of a raw, less refined kind of energy. Yeah. Obviously it's not as produced, right? This is a very produced album.
Yeah.
But like, if somebody was to say, what's the U2 album that you should like, that defines the band, it's this one. It's easily this one. It's got three of their biggest songs ever are one, right, two, they two, lead three. Off, yeah, they lead off the record. I was talking to Sherry about this. I've seen a couple of, like, cause U2 just had an album come out. So there's been a bunch of like,
right,
U2's top 40 songs of all time ranked, right? And I see like With or Without You is like 7 or 8, and I'm like, how is that not in the top 5? Like, how is it, you know, it's just like, it's you know, that's, I don't know, that's my own quibble with it, but I've known this album for a while. I don't think I really started listening to this till I was in college. I just knew the first three songs like most other people, but this is an absolutely solid album straight through. This is where they refined their craft. I mean, we heard some of this happening on the Unforgettable Unforgettable Fire. I think that was an interesting album that bridged kind of their previous, you know, their early sounds to what would become the U2 sound, you know, namely like Edge's guitar, which is that effect that he's using. The Edge is all over this record with that distinctive guitar sound in pretty much every song. Bono's voice is on full force here, you know, the end of With or Without You, that the chorus in Red Hill Mining Town is just like, man, just like, find me a better rock vocal performance than that. I mean, he's just, he has got, we talked about this before, I know I mentioned this before, he's got like one of the best rock voices of all time. Just like that's kind of cross all genres, really. That doesn't, it's not really distinctive for like metal, it's just rock and like pure rock voices. He shines on this record. You know, a lot of times, I know Octune Baby gets a lot of love, you know, a lot of, you know, sometimes that's kind of put up there as the top, you know, U2 album. To me, this is much, the highs on this are better than the highs on that. That this has, this is more consistent. There's a lot of great deep cuts on this. I am interested to go back on Octune Baby, but my recollection of that album is I like it. It's almost kind of similar to what your reaction to this record was, Josh, is that I like it, but it doesn't blow me away.
Yeah.
And in a sense, this album, like, as much as I love this record, U2's a band that doesn't necessarily blow me away. They're not one of my top bands of all time. You know, I like them fine. I do think that they get, you know, you guys are talking about, you know, what they did in later years and how they've kind of maybe been hanging on too long, you know, or whatever, and they become a caricature of themselves. But that's when artists do that, it still doesn't take away from the great stuff that they might have done earlier, the stuff that you liked earlier, you know. So if you want to, you know, you could not pay attention to those records, but always come back here, because this is going to welcome you in. This is going to give you a lot, you know, scratch a lot of different itches. This is going to be upbeat. It's going to rock out. It's going to give you some interesting turns here and there, like Bullet the Blue Sky is kind of a, you know, that's an interesting song that follows the first three, and you kind of go into that, which is kind of like this heavier, you know, edgier kind of song. Actually, that one's probably maybe the least polished or least clean production on that of the songs on here.
That was the one I liked the most, I think.
Yeah, it's kind of like, okay, now we're gonna get a little heavier on that, and then they do.
It sounds like War. It sounds like War.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, and then you go to Running to Stand Still, which is just—it's a beautiful ballad. That's such a pretty song. You know, that's—I've always, you know, I was trying to think of like what's my favorite non-first three tracks song on this. You know, and Running to Stand Still is up there, man. That's a great tune. But like I said, it goes to Red Hill Mining Town's a great way to open. That opens the second side. In God's Country, another Trip Through Your Wires is like a blues. Kind of like at the harmonica blues sound, like harmonica. Kind of going in there. Yep. Exit's kind of like a Joy Division song. You know, I was thinking that this week when I never really thought of that before, but that's another one of the edgier songs on this. And it's like a darker, you know, more ominous sounding song. And I'm like, man, I could see kind of Joy Division and Ian Curtis doing a sound like that. Yeah. And Mothers of the Disappear is just like a nice little outro. You know, it's on the longer side, but it's a fitting end to this. So, you know, a lot of those deep cuts, you know, really shine. You know, this is an excellent record. I totally see why this sold a ton of copies in a very short period of time. Yeah. They also started blowing up on MTV around here. You know, the opening, Where the Streets Have No Name, is an all-time great opening track. You know, that opening guitar line, it's just the way it builds in there. You're right, Josh, there's a lot of building in this, which I always
really
love.
Sets,
you know,
the stage in a nice way for that.
Totally. And it's just like this epic sounding song, you know. I still haven't found what I'm looking for. It's kind of like a gospel song, you know. And I think they actually did do that. Maybe was that in Rattle and Hum or whatever? They got like a gospel choir behind to sing all the different parts there. And it's a very that's a very spiritual song as well. And just With or Without You, man, that just gets me every time. They're using some 80s effects there and whatnot, but it's just, you know, it's such a simple song, and the way it builds and each one of their parts is great. You know, the bass, it's just, and Bono's voice at the end. It's fantastic. You know, this record, this is, you know, if you're going to listen to one of U2 album, this is it. You know, even though you might, you know, at times you might want to grab a, you know, War because you're looking for that type of sound. But this is like, this is where they honed in their craft and became the band that is who they are today, for better or worse. But if you want the better, just come back here. So big thumbs up on this. I'm interested to see where, as I start putting my best of list together, if this is going to make it. It certainly could. But again, having said all that, as much as I love love this record. There still is a part of me that's not like over the moon for U2. They're still yeah. like, you know, I like them plenty. I respect the hell out of them. And I think that they're, you know, they're unique and everything like that. But it's still, there's still something I can't get quite. It's not so much this record. It's just them as a whole. I just can't get to the next levels being like, this is one of my all time favorites. So, but for this record, yeah, it's great from start to finish. Big thumbs up for me.
Okay, so yeah, I'm going to touch on a lot of things you guys touched on, but like in my own thing, like first I'll talk about, I can absolutely separate like the later kind of comically yeah. over the top U2 from this U2. Like that's not a barrier for me at all. Like mm-hmm. It doesn't affect my view of this. I always think that it's kind of sad that U2 had that era because there is no doubt that probably U2's the biggest band of the 80s, but I don't think anybody realizes that anymore. And it isn't until you like listen to this album and you're like, well, of course they're the biggest band of the 80s. They made this album because this album is designed to be the biggest album of a decade. And it succeeds because it is a massive, massive piece of mass consumable rock. And I don't mean, and by the way, there is nothing negative about what I was saying right there, because it does straddle, it has artistic qualities, and it is yeah. not schlocky or you know, designed for, you know, you're looking at what else is selling around it. And this is where U2 is so interesting as a thing, because in some ways it's trying to be as big as things like Def Leppard and Bon Jovi are, right? But it is considerably more serious and substantial, oh, yeah. right? Mm-hmm. That, but you know what I'm saying? But it's also like omnipresent, like that stuff is, right? But it doesn't exist in that lane because it's there. Its influences are post-punk and punk, right? So you'd think it would slip in with like the Smiths or the Cure, but it doesn't fit there either, right? It doesn't fit in that lane. And then U2 always also falls in this interesting continuum of like, before it, you've got like The Who and you've got Bruce Springsteen and you've got these people that have these grand visions, right? Like just yeah. grand. U2, I always clump together with like Bruce Springsteen and The Who, right? And that they did a lot of stuff. Some of it I really like. Some yep. of it makes me roll my eyes. It's all sort of about their themes, right? Like Bruce has got his themes, right? And yep. U2 and Bono's got his themes,
yeah,
right?
Themes in like
America, America, God, existential life and death, right? His yeah. mother, like these things come all. It's just like Bruce likes to sing about New Jersey and youth and adult responsibilities and finding yourself, right? And yeah. The Who, right? You know, The Who did this incredible stuff, but then they did like The Seeker and the Square, these big over the top ornate things, which sometimes hit for me and sometimes don't, right? But just like, right, The Who had Who's Next, and just like Bruce Springsteen had Born in the USA, right? U2 has the Joshua Tree, and that it's like it all comes together as like the perfect synthesis of who they are. And there's this whole after that, right? There's mm-hmm. all of these people that are trying to do what U2 do later, or at least inspired by them, right? Like I think of people who have had degrees of success with it, like Coldplay, right? I feel is always trying to be U2 to oh, some yeah. degree, yeah. right? And Arcade Fire, right, is another band that like I feel tries to be U2 all the time. And then there's shittier bands that try to be U2, like Creed, right? Like tries to have elements of, you know what I'm saying? But they're all in that same lineage, right? Like,
yeah.
like The Who to Springsteen to U2 to stuff like that. And that's where it's interesting to see like what U2 is, because to some degree, U2 has like fallen off of the pop culture universe. Like they're sure. not cool enough to be cool, right? They don't quite seem to fit with anything in terms of modern influences, even though to some degree they did influence a lot of stuff. Like the whole idea of the rock star as political figure, that to some degree others tried to do it, right? Like George Harrison and stuff, but they weren't taken seriously, right? Like I gotta give Bono credit, like he actually got taken seriously being that guy, which
Yeah,
you really don't see too many guys that transcended that, right? For the most part, it's like, oh, look at these rock stars like The Clash or, you know, like George Harrison getting involved. It's good that they think about
well,
that.
Well, Bono
stuff,
would
right?
meet but, with yeah. presidents and heads well, of state and travel. I mean, he was at the State of the Union this year, you know?
And this is what I'm going to get to. Like, Bono and the band almost became, like, this version of U2 is the perfect synthesis of it, and it's enjoyable. But to some degree, they leaned into this lean, right, and kind of did it and expanded on it when they really didn't need to, right? And I think that maybe would hurt them, you know, and maybe miscalculate it. There's also a little element of, like, as she got older, Madonna, where she was so ahead of the curve for so long until she wasn't, but then you kind of could see that somewhat desperation, right? And mm-hmm. I feel like that happened to U2 a little bit in the 2000s, where it was just they were trying to find another way to be cutting edge, but, like, they were no longer cutting edge, right? Like, they didn't want to be a nostalgia act, which I respected, but they weren't able to be trendsetters either anymore. They were elder statesmen at that point, but they didn't mm-hmm. live in it. Anyway, that's another thing going along. I completely get where you guys say that it's set back a little bit, but the fascinating thing to me about U2 is always, and this album's a great example of it, they belong to everything and nothing at the same time. In terms of their musical lineage, right? Because we could sit and talk about, like, 100 different acts that have elements of U2 or seem to influence U2 while also not being able to draw any direct corollaries. And that starts with, like, Edge's guitar play. There's a lot of space, right? So you start saying, okay, like, who are Edge's, like, guitar forerunners? And you say, well, maybe, you know, Pink Floyd, right? Like, David Gilmour, maybe. A little bit. There's a little bit of the ringing sound, right? Has a little mm-hmm. bit like the effect that like Jangle has. Mm-hmm. So you get a little bit of that, but not exactly, right? Like you don't draw an exact corollary there. He's experimenting with, you know, R&B/blues themes here, but he's not playing blues or R&B, right? Even the post-punk influences, you know, do you see direct, you know, the people they say influence them, like, you know, the Jam or, you know, Television, or, I mean, maybe Television is like the best corollary for the way Edge plays guitar. Hmm. You know, mm-hmm. it's somewhat similar to the sound of Television, but, and so that's interesting. And then, like, who is Bono? The closest corollary I could think of is somebody like Bruce Springsteen, right? Like singing these, you know, these over the top things. He resembles more like, you know, Bruce Springsteen or Billy Joel, right? Than he does a rock singer. I guess Roger Daltrey is the closest corollary I can find.
I don't know if I see Billy Joel. I mean,
but I'm saying, like, in terms of the themes, you know what I mean? Like the theme of what he's okay. trying to do, like as a performer, right? Like maybe Billy Joel's, I'm trying to explain, like he's going for big. He's playing.
He's anthemic. It's like
big.
Everything's
anthemic,
like it's a big
yes.
anthemic arena, you know, stage
and that's,
performance.
That's Roger Daltrey. That's,
yes.
you know, but he doesn't have the pageantry of like Elton John or a Freddie Mercury, right? So he doesn't yeah. quite fit like them either.
Correct.
And I guess what I was going with Billy Joel was sort of that same idea of like the, you know, playing for the biggest audience possible, right? But yeah, maybe not the greatest comparison there, but you know, Daltrey and Springsteen might be it. And then you've got this really underrated rhythm section that I think is very good, but they're the definition of, they exist to serve the guitar yes. parts and Bono's voice. So it's kind of like the Ringo argument, right? Like, is Ringo a great drummer? Is Ringo the perfect drummer for the band he was in? Is Ringo not as good because his like none of the answers are accurate. That's how I always feel U2's rhythm section is. They're so dwarfed by these two supernovas around them, but they're equally as important, because if you took out the rhythm section of U2 songs, they wouldn't sound right.
Right.
They just wouldn't, you know, and you can't just replace them, because those guys learned how to weave themselves in between mm-hmm. those two big sounds. And that is not easy to do, right? Because you just, you can't infringe on those two sounds. How do you play like that and yet still have a presence? So, like, I always give those guys a little bit of credit, because it can't have been easy. So this falls in that category of, how do you rank an album that is as massive as this, right? It's just sort of it's a touch point of the 80s. It is the album that made U2 the biggest rock band of the 80s, in an era when there weren't a lot of serious, right, credentialed rock bands that also were popular.
Yeah.
When you think about it. Because the popular rock in this era was not considered to be the serious, critically acclaimed rock.
It was more the feel-good party, hair metal, glam rock, you know, to have, you know, stuff like that. Or the synth, AOR. Or
AOR. Like, mm-hmm. you had throughout the
having
early
a good
80s.
Time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Or, yeah. You had that stuff, but you also had like Journey and REO Speedwagon and like lighter rock, you know, along the way. You had things being called rock that was sort of more, it was the beginning of that where like the rock started to sound synthy and stuff, but not in the serious artistic way, right, that it was in England, right? It was much more pop and lightweight. So yeah, U2 filled that space. And you know, REM would occupy the same space, but later. They're not there yet, right? They didn't become that band till the late 80s and probably not truly until Out of Time, right? Which was their Joshua mm-hmm. Tree in some ways. Yes. So, and that's where, you know, they exist sort of as the people, you know, this is going to be blasphemy to you, Matt, but to some degree, U2 filled the Beatles role, right, in the 80s.
I don't know if I'd say it's blasphemy. I mean, they were.
You know what massive, I'm saying, though? They filled the serious, huge rock band. They were both rock and critically acclaimed.
Yes, they got both of those. They did ride and yes in that lane in both of those lanes. That's true. Yes.
Yep. And as Josh comes to them, right? Like you probably know that Josh, but also can't even fathom it, right? Because of what they became later and. That's the ultimate U2. But they're all those things.
You've done a good job of like explaining context and important stuff, but did you enjoy listening to the album? Like,
yeah.
Is it?
I did. Yeah. I did. I remember the joke I made about the Boston album. Like, it's mm-hmm. like, I don't think I've ever sat down and listened to this album, but I've listened to it by proxy, just hearing the songs. And certainly there's not enough singles on this album that I can say the same thing about, but I just in different pieces and along the way, this album has just always been omnipresent by me, which is funny because I don't really have any people in my life who are U2 partisans. And yet everybody I know knows U2. So that's
like
kind
of
the other thing about
the band,
U2.
Right? Yeah. It's yes. Like...
Oh, but I knew acquaintances who like loved U2, like went to see them 70 times. Right. But that's the thing. Like, I didn't know any of them as direct friends, and most of my friends didn't have any friends that were like that. But we all knew plenty of people who loved U2. So, and it's sort of, I don't want to say the silent majority, but that's what it was.
And, yeah. And U2, yeah. U2 remains the band that, of all bands that I haven't seen live that I would most want to see live, they're number one. Like I would like even today, I would go see I should go see a U2 show. Like if they're coming around here, I should probably like that's a band I should see, you know, like just
the fact that you, the music lover, haven't seen U2 is a perfect illustration, though, of what we're saying, too. Like they're like important enough that they would be number one on your list, but not so important that you've seen them yet.
Yeah, just never. I don't know. I never sought them out and it never like just happened. It's just I'm just realized I'm like, I've never seen U2. I should probably do that.
I had a conversation with a friend of mine who's about a decade younger than us. So he's, you know, he's early 30s, I think. And like I was telling him, he was saying something like, oh, U2, they're not very good, right? I'm like, oh, no, U2's got plenty of good songs.
Yeah.
And then I went into the role of talking up U2, which it's funny because with another group of people, I probably would have been like, ah, I don't really, you know, U2.
yeah.
And it's like somehow they can be both, right? Like I could go to somebody and go, no, they're way better than you're saying they are. And then with somebody else go, well, let's not go that far. And it's like, that's, there's no other band I can say that about.
Yeah it's like a weird, like you have to qualify everything with them. Like there's some,
like if somebody said to you now, Josh, like U2 sucks, you would have to say they don't suck, right?
Right.
Like in any way they don't suck.
Categorically
it's categorically incorrect. In fact, I'll categorically say they not only don't suck, they're good. But like you wouldn't go all in and say, oh, they're like the greatest if somebody was there. You'd be surprised that somebody said that. Yeah.
You might have done that if they stopped after Octoon Baby.
Yeah,
they had broken up after Octoon Baby, because after that they started doing, then they started polarizing their own fans because they did Zooropa and Pop, which was totally different than anything, right?
Well, and then the 2000s version of them became like the most. It's all of the traits of them that I didn't like as much without the profundity, I guess. They almost became like a caricature of U2. It's kind of like what I joke about with Springsteen sometimes. He's, you know, we did like The Rising, right? It's like, oh God, you know, this is like Springsteen and his most Springsteen, right? And it's that's it. And you know, The Who became that too a little bit at times. But
that's what happens when you have the longevity. It's like invariably, like, and if you're that passionate into what you're doing, like you're going to be more susceptible to that type of, like, because being able to sustain that over decades and decades that, like, you're not going to be able to do it. So, you know,
you also
but
have to
like,
be big enough that people give a shit that you have this other career they don't like as much.
But the other thing I was going to say about, you're talking about Edge's guitar playing, maybe I mentioned this before, but I love the Edge's sound, but I remember watching the It Might Get Loud documentary with Jack White and Jimmy Page, and the Edge, they're all like talking about how they do everything, and Edge's is like, his thing is just knowing how to get the sound out of his guitar. So he's like more of like a studio guy. I wouldn't call the Edge like a, he's not like a Hendrix or like this, you know, this virtuoso guitar player in terms of like the technique of the technical proficiency of his playing. He's more of like, I like to tinker around with the different sounds and effects I can get from it. And so when he was doing like examples of how to get a sound from one of his guitar parts, he's barely doing anything with the guitar in terms of his hands and his fingers. It's all coming from the pedal. When he turned the pedal on and started putting that effect on, it's like, that's how he gets the sound. So on the one hand, I totally respect that ability to kind of like have, you know, have the sense of what sound you're going for and how to get that sound out of it and make it totally your own, because nobody sounds like the Edge. He starts playing the guitar, you know it's him, and nobody, right, even people that have tried to replicate it, don't sound like him. But at the
he uses space. Like he's got a,
yes,
you guys said big sound, but I don't know if I'd say big as much as it's about the ringing and the space, right? Like in how he plays. It's very hard to explain.
But it can be a big sound. Like when the Streets Have No Names is like, that's a very big sounding, you know.
It's like the notes ring more, or there's like echo to them in some way.
And that's his, and that's, to me, that's Edge's true talent, right? Like, but if you just see him play, I don't think he's doing anything all that like impressive, like in terms of a professional guitar player, like, you know, technique and soloing and whatever, but he's got this ability to harness a sound that nobody else has been able to do. And it sounds great. It's just, it's a really great sound that he's got.
Yeah.
Well, he also like is really great at complimenting Bono's bombastic voice, right? And like you said, like the sound and Where the Streets Have No Names, a big sound. But then when you listen to like how he plays when Bono starts, you know, going into like, still burning in that, you know, like that, like he does recede a little bit if you listen to it.
Oh,
it's
not
that
wall
of sound.
Right.
Well, and that's what I'm saying. He uses space a lot. Like the sound is huge when Bono hasn't come in yet, but then there's space again, right? When Bono's cutting it up. So even in a song like that with such a big sound, he still uses, and that's where I compare him a little bit to the guy I always think of as like David Gilmour, and what he does in Pink Floyd is really, to me, you know, while they don't sound exactly the same, like what they view their role in, right, in the band, like I think is similar to me. And the more I listen to the Pink Floyd, the more I started to draw that corollary, just because I had never done such a concerted listen of so much Pink Floyd. But I was like, gosh, he's very similar to the Edge.
Yeah.
So, mm-hmm.
It's funny, Matt, when you said earlier about the, you know, the lists coming out and the new album, I didn't put that together. And I think a couple weeks ago was the anniversary of Joshua Tree's release date. And then on Disney Plus, I saw, you know, they're like headlining Disney Plus with a Bono and the Edge, a sort of homecoming with David Letterman. It's like an hour and a half movie about, you know, them performing and all this stuff. And like, I see that, and my immediate reaction is just like to roll my eyes. And it's like,
sucks.
Like,
which, and that sucks. We should not, the first thought when somebody mentions U2, your first thought should not be, oh crap. You know what I mean? Like, they're too good of a band for that to be your first reaction. Yeah. Now that might come out in conversation later on, or John, like what you're saying, when somebody's like talking about how they're the amazing, or whether they're being so effusive, you have to be like, all right, slow your roll, because they got plenty of clunkers along the way. But like, they're still a really good band, right? They're right. still a great band, as John's a band of the 80s, whatever you want to call it. But they've got so much good stuff, and it's too bad that like that can happen sometimes. Well, that's what somebody's knowledge base of, like somebody that's younger than us going, right. I don't really know War or the Joshua Tree or like Octoon Baby, but you know, but like this, the album that the Apple album sucked, you know, whatever. Like that should not be your go-to.
And it really only came out to me when somebody was basically like writing them off as like, you know, haha boomers. It's like, no, you too.
No.
That's not you. And that, like, I felt this weird urge to defend, you know, weird. Just, and I didn't really realize that they resided in that until that happened, where I'm like, no, that's a lazy ass take. And you don't get to make that take until you've listened to all their 80s albums, because you can't make that take just by having heard two songs and know the Apple thing, right? And haha, South Park made fun. It's like, yeah, we all went through that too and can chuckle. But like, you don't get to have that lazy take and pretend that like U2's not a big band, because they are. And I was like, wow, I was much more forceful in that take. But yeah. But I have a feeling both you guys would jump into that take too.
Oh, absolutely. No, U2's great. I will say U2's still great, you know, but they're not as great as they used to be. You know, they're you know,
I think like you guys said too, because they're still around, there's not that period of reevaluation like a lot of other bands from this era and from before, where there's no retrospective, because they're still like making new albums and stuff.
But,
so it's
but
like,
are you going to even reevaluate? Because they were so right in your face at all times. I feel like I don't even know what a retrospective of U2 would be. Because
you're going to do a retrospective of something like Zooropa, or you're going to do something like the Atomic
there's no
Bomb
subtext
album.
With U2. There's just text, right? And so like, what do you even go back and reevaluate?
I don't know. Yeah. I'm just not seeing articles like, hey guys, U2's really awesome or something like that. You know, like there's not that critical, I don't know. It's so interesting. You know, we keep talking about like kind of their legacy, I guess, and their impact on the culture and stuff. I don't know. I just feel like that hasn't come in some sense. Time, every band will get
And I think that's like Paul McCartney
is being treated as serious throughout. Yeah.
Yeah, or that's like when later on when Paul McCartney's Ram comes out, and it's like that's the Paul McCartney album, which is like, who was saying that like in any time before 2015 or whatever, you know what I mean? Like, so I could see something like that happening, but again, I just go back to the fact that like if the initial take on U2 when you hear U2 from whether it's a journalist or a fan or whatever is going to be like mockery, I mean, no, that's wrong. Yeah. That is not that's a conversation that happens later on, you know, after you spend talking about it for like 15 minutes or something, then you can bring that up.
And mine is you can mock them, but you don't get to like take it all the way out to like, they weren't a big band. Like, you just can't say that. And that was where it started.
Or great or relevant or whatever. Yeah.
Relevant and that they weren't big are the things that I've heard from people recently. And it's like, that's just insane. That's just not true.
That's not true. Not true.
And in that, it's like
I don't know what I'm talking about, so let me just say something that clearly shows I don't know what I'm talking about. But
we'll read them later.
Yeah, so I think I would say I'm definitely thumbs up. John, Josh, you're three thumbs up too.
Yeah, I'm thumbs up too
for sure. Yeah,
I think it's an album actually that I need to like keep listening to in some way, like just not keep it in rotation.
Nope, it's good. Take all that's the thing. Like when you kind of, we just talked about with Jane's Addiction, right? With me, you know, it's like you got to wash yourself clean of those thoughts or that narrative that you built up in your head or whatever that's there, and just kind of let it speak for itself, you know?
Well, it's also play U2 for people that have never heard U2, which actually exists nowadays, right? With younger people. I think it would be,
Josh didn't know this album.
U2 would hold up better with modern music than you'd think without context, because it doesn't scream rock music in the way that turns off like younger people sometimes now, that they're like, oh, the rock sounds too heavy. It does have the elements that would, you know, merge into the modern era a little bit more if you're like 16 years old and you have absolutely no concept of U2, you know, like I'd be curious to see somebody listen to it from that era to see what they think. So maybe I'll play this for some of the students I work with.
Yeah. The Utes. They're gonna reclaim U2 for themselves.
Maybe. So
hey, side note here, John, you kept bringing them up, but I forgot to mention I saw Springsteen on Monday night.
Oh, did you?
Nice. I did. Yep. So he's in full force in the tour and everything like that. 2 hours and 50 minutes. Plenty of baby boomers dancing their asses off, John. You would have loved it.
Oh, yeah. It sounds like my thing. That 17-minute rendition of Jungle Land, I'm sure.
He didn't do Jungle Land. No, 15, he's not playing that this tour.
15-minute combination Reverend Street speech leading into, like, 10th Avenue freeze-out.
I will say... The Reverend speech was subdued. He didn't do that as much, actually. So he's, I think he's definitely sounding, it's harder for him to hit the notes. The solos aren't as extensive as they used to be, but it was still a fun
show. Encore of either Thunder Road or Born to Run.
Yep, they were both in there, Dancing in the Dark. Yep. Glory Days, that's your favorite one. That was the one that brought the house down, so yeah.
With people taking it literally instead of how Bruce Springsteen actually meant to be, which always makes me laugh when people are singing their heart off relating to it, is you wonder if Springsteen's just thinking his head, bunch of fucking idiots. So, yeah.
Yeah, bunch of fucking idiots that just spent a bunch of money to see him. So,
right, yeah, same thing. Yeah. Yep. So, okay. Well, we have a cold.
That was an hour long segment, by the way. That was just about an hour from when John started the bio on YouTube. Yeah.
I mean, Joshua Tree's a big enough album to justify that, let's be honest. So.